relationship about these two resources. And definitely the water resource and energy resources, these are studied independently, but they are also interdependent. So the Nexus highlights the need to study the use and management of both resources together. Although sectors such as water and energy can be analyzed independently, doing so would overlook the multiplicity of feedbacks and interdependency that jointly affect their sustainability. Choices. I hope I am audible.
Yes, ma'am. You are audible.
Okay. So, in today's session, I will be dealing with the meaning of this water energy nexus and the interlinkages between two, as well as I will share my case studies, two case studies, as in my introductory, sir, you sir already mentioned that I have done projects, different projects, and I did two projects funded by University of North Carolina and IIM Bangalore. And through these case studies, I will try to show the interlinkages and the significance of how we are handling our resources. So as I was telling that when we talk about water energy nexus, that the word nexus itself highlights that what is a need, what is the emergency that press us to use the resources in a sustainable way. The reason behind that the choices we made and our own action taken in one domain can badly affect the other, positively or negatively. And these two resources are interlinked not only with industry, agriculture, environment, but we can say that these two resources, which are mutually inclusive, affect our life on day-to-day basis. And that is the reason that the water resource and energy resource, the sustainability of water resource and energy resource that has been highlighted by Sustainable Development Goals. And it is also mentioned in the reports that unless we develop, we manage the resources, interdependency, keeping the interdependency factor in our mind, we cannot actually reach up to the goal of poverty elevation. So what I want to highlight is that no doubt water and energy have crucial role in poverty elevation, but there are certain factors because of that the problem is emerging. And these emerging factors are urbanization, population growth, economic growth, the urban expansion at world level, and that is the need. That is the reason because of which there is an additional pressure on water-intensive energy production. Now, why I use this water-intensive energy production? Because if we analyze all the countries, we'll know that particularly in Asian countries, either India or our neighboring countries, they are using the resource, they are producing the energy which is very much dependent upon water. So before coming to the case study, I would like to highlight what are the interlinkages of water for energy and energy for water. The view of the nexus motivates the need for research and investment that can conserve resource through more efficient technology. Because when we have to pump the water, when we need to transport the water from one place to another place, and even when water is polluted, when industries, we are trying to restore the quality of the water, when we are distributing water from one sector to another sector, we need energy. In the same way, in the domain of thermoelectric cooling, hydropower, mineral extraction, and fuel production, we need water. So water and energy both are used simultaneously, and that is the interlinkage between these two resources. Now, so far as today's discussion is concerned, it is all about water energy nexus in industry. So what is the role of water energy nexus in industries is, as we all know, that it's in its internal operations or external reach, industries both use and misuse water. And in doing so, we consume the energy. So the point here is that if we are misusing the water, we are also misusing the energy simultaneously. And what is the way forward? The way forward is the use of technology in a very intelligent way that we can save, we can conserve our resources, and that can be utilized not only in that particular industry but also outside. So what I'm trying to highlight that this Nexus, which is a very world-known issue nowadays, and the focus is that the efficiencies are usually which are driven in terms of cost and benefit as they relate to companies' profit, although government policies, legislations can significantly influence the situation. So the focus is on efficiency, which translate to reduce water and energy use in a plant. One potential result in reduction in water and energy stress out the factory walls in communities and river basins where it operates. And that is what I am going to show through my case studies, that how and in what manner industries can play a significant role to conserve water. And while conserving the water, we are also conserving the energy, and that can be used outside. So that is how we can contribute globally. I can use the word locally because nowadays the emphasis is on local to global level participation. So how one entity or one organization can actually contribute to attain the goals at international level? That is the highlight of this particular case studies. And as I mentioned that the first sentence of this particular statement is related to regulations. So in India, when it is related to utilization of water resources, it is majorly it's in the hand of central and the state government, and the policy and legislation involved in that is very significant. And luckily, all over the world, I can't say that it's a rule, but nowadays the norm had come at world level. First, it started from Europe and followed by America, and then other countries, they started implementing the norms of corporate social responsibilities in private sector. And realizing the significance of that, even in India also, it was adopted by few of the industrial sector to build the trust among their consumers. And that is how gradually it is becoming a norm. Now the Indian government had also made it compulsory that the industries which are earning more than 100 crore per annum, they should invest at least 2% of their profit annually in the area of CSR. So that's the reason that I thought of sharing with all of you my two case studies. These case studies are, one is related to Electronic Corporation of India Limited. This was a project funded by University of North Carolina, and we studied the sustainability aspect, how industries are investing the CSR money to conserve the resources. So I'm not going to discuss because I have less time. That is why I will discuss only the findings of my study. And as per the finding, I went and I tried to collect the primary data from ECIL Hyderabad. And then I got to know that as per the observation, ECIL is presently using both ETP treated water and municipal water for gardening purposes. The main aim of this was to reduce the usage of municipal water and increase the quantity of ETP treated water. So please see here that, as I said, that in India, the water distribution or water supply is majorly regulated by government bodies. And here comes the role of municipal water bodies. To reduce the consumption of municipal water bodies, in ECIL, they tried to establish ETP treated plants, and through that, there is a huge reduction in consumption of municipal water for gardening purposes, as well as they have laid pipes from ETP to the green areas and pumping the ETP treated water for gardening purpose. And you can see that in the financial year 2011-12, the water consumption was 41,612 kiloliter. And in 2012-13, after implementation of this policy, it reduced to 34,599 kiloliter. So if within a year, if you see percentage-wise, if within a year, then can be reduction of 16.85%, which is close to 17%, then after following this year by year, you can imagine that how the dependency on municipal water can be reduced by using the entity's own plants. So that was a really fine case study. And the second case study is related to SEL, that is, yeah. In this also, as I was mentioning that the role of industries are very significant in the current era, because you can see that in the ETP second, with the capacity of 650 kiloliter per day is under construction, and they are likely to, that they have already implemented it. And what they did is that now they are recycling the water. And the recycling of water was also planned to use for the horticulture and using toilets to in the tune of 500 kiloliter per day. So further saving that were expected that time in terms of rupees, that were 2 crore 43 lakhs. So for the saving, in the same way, they are trying to replace the entire water tap with push type water turn, because if to ignore the wastage of water, and doing so, again, the saving is expected to be close to 1 crore 80 lakhs. So the big organization, these kind of step is taking, which is not only saving the water resource, but the energy also to distribute the water in that particular area and to recycle the water. And as I said, I will again take you to my first slide. Let me take you all to my initial slide, in which I mentioned, one second. Yes, so here I was mentioning that when these efficiencies translate to reduce water and energy use in plant, one potential result is reduction in water and energy stress outside the factory walls, in communities and river basin where it operates. So there, you can see that there are many advantages of conserving water by that particular industry. And second, I'll take only 5 minutes. I hope I'm not running, I'm not taking much time. So I will take another 3-4 minutes. So another case study is from Singareni Colliery. And in this also, we observed that they are actually focusing on all the areas. Like in ECIL, the focus was to conserve the water and to replace the tap water with other technologies to reduce the to ignore the wastage of water. Now in FCCL, I observed that it's the overall development, because what they are doing is that first is that groundwater seeping into underground mines and open cast working that is pumped out as mine discharge is treated for removal of suspended solids and is mostly used to meet the company's requirement. Second is mine discharge is treated by sedimentation, filtration, and chlorination when used for drinking purpose. Remaining water is utilized for dust separation. So how are they trying to increase the quality of water? That is being mentioned. The third is that garland drains are made along the dumps along the less area to restrict the suspended solid entering into the natural water regime, as well as to prevent storm water entering these areas. Apart from that, one point which I would like to highlight it here, I hope my slides are visible. The second point you can see is fourth point, that is on groundwater level are being periodically monitored through a network of around 300 observation wells and around 100 piezometers in the mining area and surrounding villages. And mine water is being supplied to villages where water scarcity has been reported. Apart from that, check dams, roll fill dams are constructed where necessary to reduce siltation with suspended solids. So the one aspect I highlighted about the water conservation by an entity. Now, second, which I am trying to highlight is the groundwater management. Why groundwater management is very important, majorly in the South Indian states, because of its topographic condition. Because in North India, the rivers and the soil, that is in such a way that percolation of water takes place easily compared to the topographic condition of South India. And that's the reason that there is a need to conserve the water, to store, so that it will increase the percolation of groundwater, which will result into increase in the groundwater level. Because I did many studies that was related to a comparison of South Indian and North Indian states, the comparison of alluvial Ganga plain with the Vindhyan plateau. That also I found that even in spite of unavailability of groundwater resources, the farmers of that area, I surveyed close to 600 villages in one of the study. And what I found that because of the green revolution, they got subsidy in energy sector also to install the tube wells. And without having any scientific knowledge about the level of water beyond which they should not extract the water, the farmers, big farmers, they have extracted the water and they started selling the water to the small farmers. So doing so, what happens is that they badly impacted the groundwater level in that area. Because scientifically, you should not extract groundwater beyond a level. And if a person is unaware of this fact, they may go beyond that level. And once if the groundwater quality, the groundwater quantity deteriorates, it will also impact the quality. And as we know that because of the climatic change, the availability of surface water is very unpredictable. Apart from that, you can also see that at what level the water quality is being deteriorated. So seeing all these things, there is a need that we should manage the water resource in such a way that it will balance the surface water and groundwater consumption. And that is what in the Singareni collieries we try to analyze. The second point, please see the second point, that the excess water that is released to the nearby irrigation tanks, which are being used by nearby villages for irrigation and also augmenting the groundwater table there. So in nutshell, I can say that around 60% of the mine seepage water in entire coal belt of Singareni collieries is used for drinking, industrial and plantation purpose after necessary conventional treatment. Now, again, I will highlight one aspect is that the treatment which is done there or which is being adopted, that is conventional in nature. So I hope I'm not taking time. So I will come to the last slide of my discussion. And this I'm referring from International Renewable Energy Agency as a way forward of my discussion. And that is the emphasis should be shifted to the use of renewable energy that can be used to produce and process water. We all know that water can be used to produce renewable energy, such as irrigation for bioenergy crops, hydropower for electric production, pumped hydro for electric storage, cooling of water for thermal power plant. And in the same way, the renewable energy can be used to produce and process water, like pumping and water distribution, drinking water preparation, wastewater treatment. And this is what I tried to explain through these two case studies. And that is the way forward, we can say, that the water can be stored easily, electricity not. Water as solution for renewable energy intermittency. In parts of the world, energy and water are scarce. Solution for one scarce resource should not increase scarcity for another resource. Thank you very much, all of you. Over to the moderator. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Anupama, for that wonderful presentation. Now we will move on to the second presentation for the day. As Mr. Dinesh has been mentioning in the beginning, that this webinar series has been a joint venture of Society of Energy Engineers and Managers and Energy Management Center. And this is the third of the series that every month we will be joining hands with EMT to make a presentation on one of the topics that is covered by the quarterly magazine produced by Society of Energy Engineers and Managers since 2008. Actually, this magazine is supported by a French agency called ADEM. And I'm really happy to see that the advisor of ADEM, Dr. Mohanty, is also here among the participants. And one of the issues that we discussed was on water energy. And the next two presentations will be based on the two papers we have published in that magazine. Any one of you who is interested to read the paper, I can share my email address at the end of the program and I can share you the copies. So the next, as per the schedule of Energy Management Center, will be a presentation by Dr. Hariharan Chandrashekaran. And in, he is one of the advisory members and editorial members of this quarterly magazine. And he is an economist who turned into business in the mid 80s. And he has presided over a lot of projects on water, energy, and green buildings over the last 25 to 30 years. And he is the founder of Biodiversity Conservation India Limited, known as BCIL. And he's also one of the initiators of the Z Group. For zero energy development homes, creating more than 5,000 homes that are zero energy developed with near zero dependence on city civic infrastructure for energy, water, and waste. He's the chairman of Altec Foundation and strategic advisor for the New Bengaluru Central University, apart from being mentor for companies and institutions in the sustainability space. Dr. Chandrashekaran Hariharan is a builder, innovator, technology scout. He also runs columns in national dailies and portals on urban sustainability. He has been a consultant for Government of Uttaranchal, Kerala, and Nagaland on eco-conscious tourism infrastructure and shape environmental policies. And I was told that Dr. Hariharan will not be using any PowerPoints. And I told Dinesh that don't worry, he is an excellent orator. And I have been hearing him for quite a long time. And you don't have to worry about whether he has a PowerPoint or not. And happy to see you again and welcome Dr. Hariharan for your presentation.
Thanks, JC. Thank you, Dinesh, for the introductory remarks. Thanks to Krishna Kumar, Brahmanand Mohanty, and all the other champions who have managed to keep Energy Manager and SEAM alive and flying for as many years with quality that's been consistent, with rigorous investigations that have been rigorous and have offered very, very deep learning for energy professionals. I must say that Energy Managers, some editions of Energy Manager forms part of bedside reading for me, along with, you know, a couple of books of Ram Guha and some editions of Down to Earth and so on. Well, what I will do is this, essentially, to the lot of you, greetings once again, ladies and gentlemen who are here. I know that it's a small number of 50 plus people who are here, but extremely discerning, as I know from the sort of profiles that I have seen out there. This invitation to be part of this webinar, shall we say, began with a feature that Jayaraman had requested me to write for Energy Managers some months ago. And that had emerged from a set of preliminary investigations that a bunch of us had done in Bangalore, with the idea having been centrally initiated by Padu. As a matter of fact, Padu should have spoken first today, but I have, you know, sort of gone with whatever has been arranged for this session. I will therefore confine myself to the challenge in Bangalore with a set of number pictures, if you'll indulge me for a few minutes, that I will offer. And over three parts of some thoughts that I will share over the next 10 plus minutes, I will share with you those reflections that you may perhaps want to resonate with or help me refine in the Q&A that we may hope to have after this share of thoughts. My hope is also that some of you may want to lock minds with Padu or me or with Anupama and others on the challenge of creating a few demonstrations beyond those we already have in cities and in, you know, in segments of industry, agriculture, and so on. There's no need to reiterate that this is about water's impact on energy resources and the other way around too. Let me start with the water scenario in Bangalore. Today we have officially supply of about 132 crore liters. About 55 crore liters of this is lost by official admission on leakages and thefts. There is about 30 to 40 crore liters, depending on who is making the estimate, demanded by central chiller plants for about 1.2 billion TR of central air conditioning that Bangalore has got between air-cooled and water-cooled systems. The contrast, these figures contrast with Mumbai's drinking water need alone of about 260 crores. Your guess is as good as mine on what their demand for air conditioning is. Delhi is at about 320 crore liters of human consumption. Their figures for chiller water obviously must be much higher considering the quantum of such water that is needed per TR, as you all know. Net deficit in water supply that is made out of groundwater resources in Bangalore is about 120 crore liters, though these are not figures, this is not a figure that you will find on any website or any official document anywhere. 70% of municipal grid water supply, we all know, is non-potable, being established in this city by few institutions like the World Resource Institute and others. In fact, even the Bangalore Water Supply Board admits that, if not officially, in other forums, personally, when you speak to leaders in the utility. Less than 10% of the city's discharge water is treated. Mandates for, the good thing is that in Karnataka, and in particularly in Bangalore, we have legal mandates for rainwater harvesting, for flow meters, for sewage treatment plants that have to be set up by, you know, all segments of buildings. With 100% of treated water to be used within apartments, which are over 20,000 square feet. 1.2 billion, as I said, is the central air conditioning TR estimates. This now, softener plants use the cheaper rock salts that cause higher maintenance. Evaporated salt pellets are more expensive, but that's another story, and this is not the forum for that. You will see that data is the key challenge in anything that you want to do at a citywide level as solutions go for urban sustainability. There is very limited assessment of embodied energy in water systems that have been conducted historically speaking. There are no comprehensive studies that provide detailed audit of embodied or embedded energy demands for local, regional, or, well, national wastewater systems or water systems. There's clearly a bias, as we all know, as you know as professionals, there's clearly a bias in favor of upstream water systems owned and managed by municipalities, water pumping stations, municipal water delivery pipelines, central water treatment plants, and so on. There are no studies on economic and energy efficiencies associated with water supply and with wastewater treatment. And this after at least 20 years of urging, pleading, and of consistent campaigns that have been run by institutions like SEEM. No information is found on secondary energy uses relating to end use in buildings, in agriculture, or in industrial processing. Padu will be speaking about some parts of these things on industry particularly. Bangalore has over 700,000 flats that are hosted by about 6,500 to 7,000 apartments at an average of about 50 to 60 flats to an apartment. Over 90% of this inventory was built between 1995 and now. Every third Bangalore is a flat dweller. Every 100 flats demand about 75,000 liters. About 40% of the city's demand, or about 500 million liters today, with the total demand being, as I said, about 132 crores. This 50 crore liters is needed by flats. But only half of this water that is offered by municipal water supply, as you know, is available for use at the consumer level. The rest is groundwater from bore wells owned by the buildings or drawn by tankers, which feed water at about 1.5x to 3x the cost of grid water. Municipal water supply today costs about 80 rupees to 1,000 liters. Local bore wells normally is at about 35 to 40 per KL. And tanker water costs can be as much as 250 per KL in summer, and seasons of the year, it might fall to about 120 or 150 rupees per KL. Padu has had no recourse and can't have any recourse into the future to any source of long distance supply. Politicians have explored other options that have cost over 25,000 crores between proposals that have been floated in the last, say, 7, 8, maybe 10 years. They would love to pursue such brutality of public expenditure, but despite themselves, they have had to accept that there is no water that can be secured from other rivers that are at least 300 kilometers away from Bangalore today, on the Western Ghats. This last week, the Chief Minister is again for a long distance source from Kendatu, which is about 100 kilometers from Bangalore. Now look at this story here of this new project that they are seeking to push. The approval from MOEF is crucial because 63% of the forest area of the Kaveri Wildlife Sanctuary will be submerged. And that's also the reason for the project not having taken off so far. 50 square kilometers of forest would be submerged. Remember that Bangalore is about 450 square kilometers. Of this 50 square kilometers, about 32 square kilometers or 3,200 hectares is inside the sanctuary area, and about 20 square kilometers nestle in the reserve forest area. After all the damage, the state hopes to draw about 4.7 to 5 TMC of water from the reservoir, and that to partially meet the drinking needs of Bangalore. This 4.7 or 5 TMC is just over 20% of the current demand of the city, put at about 19 TMC or 20 TMC. Current supply from Kaveri is 19 TMC, and that is officially, you can state that the water utility is getting enough water from Kaveri to meet our needs. But you know the story, as I said earlier. This source is about 80 kilometers away and about 700 meters below the Bangalore Plateau, which lies about 1 kilometer above the 960 meters above the mean sea level. Now, the cost of energy for transporting water to Bangalore has been one of the highest, at about 95 rupees per kilometer for the water utility. One TMC of water today is, as you all know, about 2,800 crore liters, or about 2.5 weeks of supply for a city like Bangalore. Every kiloliter of transport cost is about 5 units of energy every kiloliter. And you could do the math on what this means as the phenomenal impact on energy that just this bulk transport of water causes. Most discussions on these topics of energy and water remain within the domain of experts, with the tech speak actually not understood by retail users in industry or in the residential sector or among farmers, big or small. Even in domains of energy, all that the CII and other industry bodies know is to ask for tariff rebates and more supply of energy without realizing the grim import of such supply of energy from the state. For instance, if I have an industrial unit in the area development board, I pay no more than 5 rupees per kiloliter. At the residential sector, we pay probably 6 rupees. If I'm a commercial building, I pay up to 9 or 10 rupees per kiloliter here. And you know the figures in your state, in Kerala, for instance, or in states like Delhi, which are one half of what it is in Bangalore. The figures for energy are not any different in terms of whether they serve as a deterrent for use or as an ecosystem that can spawn new innovations and technologies. Experts hate speaking to the users, and their tech jargon doesn't help meet the challenge of awareness in the user segments of bulk or retail water consumers is another challenge that we all have to sort of contend with. The need is not therefore for just one more study, but for on the ground, incubated, in situ demonstrations of potential solutions of the kind that Anupama spoke about that can be identified and can, shall we say, demonstrate possibilities of replication and scale, with market economies actually driving consumer shift in preference in every segment of consumption, be it urban, agricultural, industrial, or commercial. The cost of drawing water today from deep aquifers is another story that we all know of. This accounts in Bangalore for nearly 30% of the city's daily energy demand of about 2.5 billion units, if I talk at the energy level. There are about 500,000 borewells, about 550,000 borewells, owned by public agencies, by apartments, by individual homeowners, and so on. The daily demand for bowels alone account for about 500 to 700 million units of that 2.5 billion units that the city demands today at the daily level. So what is needed? When we went about this exploration of the nexus, Padu spoke about it first, and then he came up with those very precise surgical sets of instruments, shall we say, that only Padu is capable of bringing. And this led to a few thoughts that I may want to share with you now. And you might want to see if you can, look at being inspired to do things of this kind in other areas that you work in. First, we said a scientific stakeholder-centered approach to consider complex interactions between physical components driving watershed structures across the undulating valleys of the city. You must remember that the city is full of contours. This isn't a city that is flat like most of those coastal towns. The social context of competing perspectives, needs and values, and the existing legal and administrative frameworks governing water use had to be understood. We also have to understand the biological and chemical components of domestic, industrial, and agricultural wastewater ecosystems, and I'll speak about this a little later too. We realize that we have to also secure upstream functional assessments of the external stresses on the natural ecosystem around the headwaters of the upper reaches of the Kaveri River Basin and of the Wayanad region of North Kerala that abuts Karnataka and therefore feeds rivers like Kaveri, which are tributaries of Kaveri. Understanding modifications, this idea of studying those ecosystems came about, I think, in 2009 first from somebody in the Indian Institute of Science, but has remained on paper. Nothing has been done as an action and initiative from the government or from other institutions. We also said to ourselves that we need to understand modifications and changes to the hydrological regime, natural habitat quality and availability, biotic structures in these regions of the headwaters of Coorg, in order to see that we are able to improve stream flows and local habitats. Focus on these two variables, stream flows and local habitats, alone could yield major environmental benefits and possibly sustain the flow of water in the Kaveri and meet demands for cities like Bangalore, as well as downstream demands of agriculture in Tamil Nadu. Restoring the natural ecosystems, 300 to 350 square kilometers of the water basin of Coorg and Wayanad has been strongly advocated for some years, with no one paying heed, as I said. Restoration of these upper reaches will contribute to a healthier ecosystem. There, the cost of such an effort will be minuscule in comparison to the billions and crores of rupees that successive governments have sought to spend on new projects for long-distance river water supply. A very small spend on restoring the headwaters could make a big difference to what the river could potentially yield over the next 30 years to 2050 as Bangalore battles the doubling of its population in the next 15 years and India, well, the state reaches about 80 million people from its current level of about 67. This sort of study of headwaters has to be taken up by professionals at SEAM or in other such discerning platforms in order to see the government begin to listen to what we need to be doing. Look at Kochi, for instance. You have a serious challenge of water shortages, despite the fact that you receive about 2,400 mm of rainfall. So water is not about water as much as it is about water management. One of the ideas that we have been proposing to the Bangalore Water Supply Board here is that they don't call themselves anymore the Water Supply Board, but they call themselves the Water Management Board. I'll take you through a few more things from here on how the city is experiencing a doubling in size by 2035. If there is no change in the current pace of year-upon-year growth, which is lying at about 2.8 to 3% in Bangalore. The average in India is at about 5%. Cities like Pune are growing at 12% year upon year. The little we have and understand of climate data indicate that climbing temperatures will increase the frequency and the severity of hot and dry summer conditions. These changes will place increasing strain on our riverine ecosystems within the city of, well, I would say Greater Bangalore is at about 900 square kilometers And if I were to take the four districts, urban and rural, we are at about 1,750 square kilometers. With these cascades of surviving lakes in the city that have lasted for about 400 years now, I think that the first set of lakes were built in the 16th century. Later in the 18th century, there were quite a, in the 19th century, there were quite some lakes that were built. By 1920, we had about 580 lakes as per data that has survived. But today we have no more than 83 living lakes in Bangalore. If I take the city, you will see that it is sort of cut into three broad ridges that characterize it, from its high point around the city's golf club, which is where you know, the secretariat is, and you have a couple of hotels on that stretch. From here, the city divides or sort of contours down into those three ridges. You add to this study of the ridges, the demand shortages for existing uses that will come about in the next 10 years, even more sharply, and you will see how grim the scenario that already is bad will become in this decade and the next. So what do we need? The three things that we told ourselves that could help: investigation into water use patterns at each of these building segments, or shall we say city segments, meetings with water rights holders and water users, with consistent campaigns for advocacy for IEC and so on. The third was listening to concerns and soliciting ideas to enhance demand side efficiency. And you'll hear more of that from Padu, I suppose, and he speaks. We all know that there isn't, that this challenge that we have anywhere in the country today is not for want of solutions. There are solutions right now being offered by a few sets of professionals with IRRs of over 18 to 22% for many of these solutions on the ground for companies or for apartments and so on. A health grade water treatment, for example, as a plant for a can at about 100,000 liters as drinking water system, yield you a return of about 22%, even if I were to take the cost of water at 100 rupees per 1,000 liters. But the behavior barrier to such use has been the most severe challenge that we all face here. This can come at cost of about 11 to 12 paisa a liter with pay-by-use models that are now available and offered by a few of these people in the enterprise segment. An effluent treatment plant, especially in, say, the electroplating industry, for, say, a 250,000 liters, can be offered with an investment of about 6 to 6.5 crores and an operation cost of about 24 paisa to a liter, or 240 rupees to 1,000 liters. An apartment STP or a sewage treatment plant can come for, say, 300 flats and about 200,000 liters, can come at about 45 to 50 lakhs and 10 to 12 paisa to a liter of OPEX, when actually you are paying much the same amount if you are drawing water from tankers or from the water utility at about 80 rupees. A composite water treatment system solution for 1,000 flats that somebody is working on currently in the city has brought down fresh water demand for that residential campus from 640,000 liters to 65,000 liters, a fall of 90% in the demand for fresh water. Solutions for hot water needs in a 200 flats apartment, for instance, can come at a cost of no more than about 130 rupees per 1,000 liters for hot water, with a combination of PV and thermal and heat pumps, and can cut energy demand by 75 to 80%. There are many such examples I'm not going to go into anymore. I'm just leaving you with a few guiding questions that have come about my way, and I'd like to see if I can learn from you all as you set out your questions at the end of this session. How much more water and energy does the city require as fresh water demand goes, or fresh energy demand goes from the central grid? How much of this demand can be met from decentralized and renewable solutions? And what are the challenges to the grid and of instability or stability if we were to produce such non-fossil fuel and feed it to the grid and take it back for use in our segments of buildings? What is readiness? The third question is, what is readiness of policy and of regulatory ecosystem to take this forward? and of course of user compliance to such regulations. I will take probably the next 3 or 4 minutes to offer you some thoughts on farms and energy. We've been working in one district of Chittalapu here. I've had the experience of working in about 3 or 4 districts in the last, say, maybe 15 or 18 years. If you look at it from purely the point of view of energy and distribution, there will be issues and concerns that people like Padu know about better and will speak about. But I will come from a slightly different context. Pumps and pumps and energy and distribution, rationalizing of the distribution grid is the least of challenges when it comes to an evaluation of water and energy or wateragy in the context of a tehsil or a mandal or even a gram panchayat at the micro level. One consortium-led program we seek to attempt needs committed players, and we're looking for them, from agri-equipment makers, from seeds and biofertilizers and biopesticides producers, researchers and agri-universities farm professionals themselves, extension service officers are people again who can contribute to a program of this kind. Of course, there are gram panchayat members, experts in watershed development who can devise simple systems at about 14,000-15,000 rupees to an acre, where I'm able to do surface water harvesting and groundwater retention at the shallow aquifer in a way that my demand, demand for water that's imported from elsewhere falls by at least 50%. Dryland and rain-fed irrigation systems that can help the farmer to see that he drops his dependence on energy that is come from the grid. We need geophysicists, we need geologists, we need understanding of soils and subsoils. We need IRSA maps and models of heat mapping in order to see if we can, at a district level, understand what you need to do on water for farmers. All of this centrally, you'll see, focuses on zero import of grid energy, and the goals will be somewhat like this. How do I improve livelihood from farms without depending on deep bore wells? How do I halve the cultivation water demand for crops? Critically, how do I bring freedom from import of seeds, fertilizers, pesticides, water, and power? There are a few trust activities that we thought we will take up if there is such a demonstration model or some model that we can inspire other villages into taking. So we chose one gram panchayat with 7 villages, or the main village and 6 of them being hamlets in a certain sense. And we have taken upon ourselves a stream of activity thinking that will lead to the following. How do we improve flowing, trough and ridge farming, seeding process, de-weeding, pruning, moisture and water for plants? How do we evolve better crop mix and patterns that are water efficient and can find markets for the farmer? How do I look at the watershed per acre and build those bunds and maybe 1 to 2 lakh liter tanks to every acre with 100 to 150 meters of land claimed for such a tank with revetments? Har mer pe ped is one of those things that was taken up as a slogan in this panchayat. And we found that farmers were willing to see that they are willing, that they work on the bunds too. Then we looked at the lakes and the local source of water with water channels for villages restored. We said we'll not look for, you know, canals, canal dependent water for the area. Fertilizing of such ideas with good farm practices from other regions was also part of the campaign. Softer footprint of tillers to gently coax life from topsoil is another thing that we took up and found that it can bring about efficiencies in water use for cultivation. There are many things like the livestock, for instance, 2 cattle and 2 sheep for every acre or for every farm owner can make a big difference to the way that he drops his dependence on fertilizers, synthetic fertilizers and pesticides. What we are saying is that if you look at any city and look at the peripheral agricultural demand of such a city for its vegetables and such, you could possibly include the farm holders as a stakeholder here, manage his water demand while you also balance the demand that you have from the city itself in those four or five segments. The discussion questions that could possibly be considered by you all would be, what are further other strategic directions that you would want to consider if you're looking at a city of the size of Bangalore, let's say, or of sizes that are much less? For instance, you know, if I were to look at cities at 400 square kilometers and about a million as population, how would you want to take this forward is one of those things that we need to be looking at. The second question is, how can we hope to secure ecosystem maturity with technology, with markets and cost for potential strategies? How can we build a stable policy and regulatory environment? I will leave it there. Thank you so much for listening to me for this while. Thanks again, gentlemen, for inviting me and Padu for this session. Thanks, Anupama, for those notes that you offered us in the beginning.
Thank you, Dr. Hariharan. That's a wonderful presentation. And you have rightly pointed out many issues like the non-availability of data and the requirement of demonstration centers and also the behavior aspect, and posed very thought-provoking questions. Now we are going to the last session, and I would like to introduce, I don't know whether I need to introduce, because he is a well-known figure across the world, Padu Padmanabhan. He's an enthusiast, advocate, writer, designer, and planner devoted to sustainable development and energy conservation. At various periods of his career, he worked with World Bank, USAID, and Government of India, various agencies of Government of India. And he also taught at the School of Advanced International Studies, Energy and Environmental Resources at Johns Hopkins University, Washington, D.C. And he's a visiting researcher at KPSRC at Riyadh, Saudi Arabia. And he was the Energy Efficiency Advisor at World Bank. He is a strategic energy and water environmental expert, providing advisory services to governments, bilateral and multilateral agencies, and institutional clients like NGOs and foundations on design and implementation of energy efficiency and clean energy strategies. I was really happy to have a talk with Dr. Padu a couple of days back and understood that he was instrumental in carrying out the first energy audit in India, and that too was in Kerala, very near to my house at Calicut at Mavur Gwalior Rhines. And I've been in touch with him for a long time. And Padu, though Dr. Hariharan said that we should have spoken first, I'm really happy that you're coming in the last session and you have got enough time. You can take as much time off as you want. And I understand that EMC won't mind if it goes up to even 12:30. And you don't have to worry about whether you are eating into somebody else's time. And you can take your own time and take the questions. And thank you, Padu, for accepting our invitation. And over to you.
Thank you, Jayaraman, and thank EMC and SEAM for this opportunity to share some thoughts on the water energy nexus in Indian industry. And a special welcome to my friend, Dr. Padmanabhan Mohanty, and hello to my good friend Hariharan, who has inspired some of the water energy nexus work. I do not have the same lucidity as Hari, and therefore we'll have to use slides. So can I have the host from EMC begin the slides?
Yes.
So Jayaraman, can I be heard?
Yes, you are very clear and audible.
The focus of my talk, as I just mentioned, is to share some ideas on the application of the water energy nexus programs and strategies in the Indian industrial sector. I am quite cognizant of the fact that my audience would largely be from God's own country, and therefore some of the ideas discussed here, excellent ideas by Dr. Dubey, and of course very, very good ideas from my good friend Hariharan, may be applicable here. Kerala receives about 3,000 mm of annual rainfall from the southwest and northeast monsoons. It has something like 44 small and medium rivers with a length of more than 15 kilometers, around 50 reservoirs, 50,000 tanks, ponds, and only about 47% of the water needs derived from groundwater. So Kerala, one would imagine, is in a very comfortable situation with respect to water, but that, however, is not wholly true. The reality is 68% of the rainfall in the state is lost as runoff to the sea. There's overexploitation of groundwater in some hydrogeological zones, and that has contributed to permanent lowering of the water table. And there are more than 6 million open wells in Kerala, and around 95% of the wells are known to be bacteriologically contaminated. Also, the growth of the bottled water industry in Kerala has led to over-extraction of groundwater in the state. And of course, there's always the threat of salinity intrusion in coastal areas of the state. So the water energy nexus programs, whether in industry or in urban areas, as Hari very rightly mentioned, and in agriculture, is not a silver bullet, nor is it a panacea to solve the state's water and energy problems. But it can provide relief and build resilience towards any effort to resolve the issues through natural resource conservation, co-management, and so on. This is going to be the outline of my talk. Essentially, very briefly talk about the water energy nexus. It has been very well covered by Dr. Dubey and later by Hari. So I'll just say a few words on it. But present a lot of data on global and India-specific water resources. And then begin to focus on the Indian industrial water and energy usage, both benchmarking it against best practices internationally, as well as benchmarking it against best practices within the country. After that, we'll talk about the water energy nexus opportunities in Indian industry, both technological opportunities as well as management practices. And then finally, end up with a roadmap of water energy nexus in Indian industry at the state level, as well as at the national level. Next. This is the visualization of the water energy nexus concept. Energy for water and water for energy. As Dr. Dubey, if I recall, said that they are tightly interlinked and highly interdependent. And as she very rightly again said, choices made in one domain have direct or indirect consequences on the other. And the choices could be either positive or negative. We all know that industrial plants use water for a number of purposes, including, you know, process mixing, which is dilution, chemical reactions, process cooling and heating, steam generation, product drying and washing, extraction, and so on. And also, we need water for room humidification and equipment sanitation. And we need energy, of course, for motors, to power electric motors, to operate pumps, compressors, blowers, and motor-driven equipment, as well as provide illumination. But it's important to note that the nature of the manufacturing process determines the amount of water required to produce that industrial product, be it textiles or paper or cement or chemicals or steel. Likewise, the form of energy production being pursued determines the amount of water required to produce that energy, be it in a hydropower plant or be it in a thermal power plant. The interconnection between the two sectors, known as the water energy nexus, has been relatively unexplored, as Hari mentioned. And in the manufacturing sector, it is not at all well understood. Next. What I will do in the next half an hour or so, cover these five important domains of water energy nexus. As I said, look very quickly on global freshwater withdrawal and consumption. Then move over to looking at manufacturing subsector water withdrawal, consumption and discharge in the Indian context. Then we will benchmark in some of the industries, and the industries I'll really focus on are the water intensive, energy intensive industries such as textiles, pulp and paper, steel and food largely. And we'll benchmark specific water and energy consumption in Indian industry, best global practices, as well as against best practices within the country. And then we'll focus on certain technologies which are in the making today to save considerable amount of water and energy. And then finally, we'll discuss the roadmap. Next. So this is the global water consumption. And very briefly, the total volume of water on Earth is estimated to be something like 1.4 trillion cubic kilometers in oceans and seas and bays and so on. And they constitute 96.5% of the global distribution of the Earth's water resources. Freshwater only constitutes about 2.5% of the total available water on Earth. It is important to note that Asia accounts for almost two-thirds of the total global water consumption, largely in China and in India. Next. Well, it's interesting that although Asia accounts for two-thirds of the global consumption of water, fresh water, the resources available in the Asia-Pacific region is only 9% of the global water availability. Much of the global water availability is in North America, which contributes, or which accounts for 41%, followed by Latin America, which accounts for 22%. Again, at the global level, 70% of the water withdrawals are for the agricultural sector, 11% are in the urban, municipal, domestic sector, and 19% is with the industrial sector. This is globally. In India, the total water consumption by agriculture is about 85%, followed by the urban domestic sector, which accounts for about 8%, and the balance 5 to 6% is by industry. Next. Okay, we have the next one. Next slide. Now again, on India, the total freshwater withdrawal in selected countries in India as against other countries is quite interesting. India actually withdraws the largest amount of water compared to every other country on the globe. We withdraw something like 761 cubic kilometers per year of water, as against China, which is about 576, USA 482, and the European Union is about 231 cubic kilometers. But what is interesting is that in the industrial sector, India's consumption, as I said, is hardly 7 or 8% of its total, and it consumes barely 12.5% of what China consumes, and approximately about 7.5% of what the US consumes, and about 15% of what Europe consumes. So as far as the industrial sector is concerned, India is still a pygmy in terms of water consumption. But we are real giants when it comes to the agricultural sector, where we consume the largest, almost double of what the China consumes, and 3.5 times more than what the US consumes, and about 10 times more than what the European Union consumes. I shall, however, be talking about India's industrial water and energy consumption because agriculture and urban has been well covered by my previous speaker, particularly by Hariharan, rather elegantly. Next. This is a very interesting graph. It shows basically that simulated manufacturing water withdrawals from for selected countries like China, India, Japan, the European Union, and USA from 1950 to 2010. Basically, what it shows is that in the year 1950, Japan, China, and India together accounted for 10% of global manufacturing water use in global manufacturing water use. It just accounted for 10%. And in that same year, the European Union accounted for something like 50 or 55%. Now, if you were to track the US water consumption, they peaked in 1980 and then they started reducing. And by the year 2010, the US was consuming less water than it consumed in 1950. And one could say the same about the European Union, which in 2010 consumed less water than in the manufacturing sector than it consumed in 1950. Japan peaked in the 70s, and since then it has been reducing its water consumption. Now, in the case of US and the European Union, and in the case of Japan, much of the reduction, in fact, its entire reduction, is because of the improvement in water use productivity. Whereas India and China have continued to increase their water consumption, and it continues to grow, although one can see some leveling off happening in the case of China, but India continues to grow. See, there is a lesson here. And the lesson here is that water withdrawal per unit of production is generally reduced by recycling water more times before discharge. It's important to note that the consumption withdrawal fraction is expected to steadily increase, as happened in the US between the year 1950 to 1980, and is expected to reach about 75% in another 10 to 15 years. This means that withdrawal efficiency increases quickly in regions with low consumption withdrawal fractions, such as India and China, and increases very slowly when the consumption withdrawal fraction is already high, such as in Japan or USA or Europe. I think the key point here is that water use efficiency, as well as the ability to recycle and reuse water, has contributed to a very large extent to the decline in manufacturing water use or improvement in water use productivity in some of the developed countries. And we in India and up to a point in China have not reached that situation yet. Next. Well, this graph shows that currently in China is the largest energy consumer, followed by the USA. This is energy consumption of top energy water consuming nations. China is the largest, followed by the USA. The industrial sector is China's largest consumer, followed again by the USA, and the EU, and then India. Next. Can we have the next slide, please? Now, this is a very interesting slide, it's a logarithmic chart on the y-axis. So that does not show you the rate of growth in the various sectors. But essentially, what it shows is that the rate of growth of water consumption has steadily increased in all the sectors in India, but its largest has been in the industrial and thermoelectric sector. In other words, the thermoelectric and industry sector, although they only consume 7 to 10% of the total freshwater consumption, are growing much more rapidly than the urban and residential and commercial sectors, or even the agricultural sector. So this is a sector which one needs to kind of really watch out for, because the demand is increasing, as you'll see in the next few slides, by leaps and bounds, whereas in agriculture, it is kind of plateauing. Next. Now, this is important because Hari touched upon this point, and I think it's important to kind of understand where we are as far as water flow in manufacturing is concerned. There are two water energy dynamics at play here. One is outside the fence, and if you think the fence is around this blue box, which is the end-use industrial sector, agriculture, as well as the commercial residential sector. So if you think the fence is around this box, one is the dynamic outside the fence. And this dynamic is really water and energy in the context of resource exploitation, water extraction and conveyance, water treatment, water distribution. These all consume energy all over the place. And this aspect of it, again, the point that Hari also mentioned, has been fairly well understood. There's been a fair amount of research work which has gone on. There's a fair amount of benchmarking, and the understanding is far better than what is happening inside this box. It is this box where the understanding is still incomplete. And also, it's important to note, this end-use segment inside here has been identified to have the highest energy and carbon emissions intensity in many regions of the developing world, and thus presents among the most attractive option to advance energy and water use efficiency. So I will be concentrating the next number of slides essentially on what's happening inside the box in the industrial sector. Next. See, this is on freshwater withdrawal, water use discharge in Indian industry in the year 2004, because that was the year in which I could get some information and data. Again, just as a background, data on water use in the industrial sector is very scanty, and not only true in India, but also internationally. Not very much data is available, so one has to kind of work with limited data resources. But I was able to access data from the Center for Science and Environment, where they had compiled data for the year 2004. The main sources of water for the industrial sector in India are groundwater and surface water. Typically, since surface water supply from municipal bodies is not very reliable, industry tends to depend on groundwater that is either available from bore wells or from their own land, or increasingly today, trucked by truckers, by tankers. Now, according to the Ministry of Water Resources, about 3,500 million gallons per day was consumed annually in industrial areas of the country, which is about 6% of the freshwater extraction. And these industries, which I have here, consume almost 90% of the total fresh water in the industrial sector. The engineering paper and textile, as I said, account for 90% of the total. And approximately the industrial sector in India accounts for 3,500 million gallons per day of fresh water withdrawal. The engineering plants is the largest, and these are very, very difficult to kind of pinpoint because they cover SME sector, MSME sector, light engineering, heavy engineering, fabrication units, and so on and so forth. But following the engineering plant, the ones which are a little more organized and where one can get information and data are the pulp and paper industry, which is at approximately at 656 MGD. Annual consumption is 152 MGD, and annual wastewater discharge is 504 MGD. And the same thing you can say about the other industries. But what is interesting is that of the total consumption of 3514 MGD in Indian industry, and 815 was actually consumed, it's the consumptive part. The discharge is 2,699, which is almost 76.8% of the total. And the annual consumption, if you take Indian industry together, is just 23% of the annual withdrawal of fresh water. As I mentioned earlier in the earlier graph, which I showed about different countries and how their water consumption has varied over time, in the US, the annual consumption is 75%, meaning that much of the water is reused time and again within the process, and that impacts the annual withdrawal. I think that is key. The more recycling, reuse, and reduction of water you are able to perform at the shop floor level, to that extent, your withdrawal of fresh water will reduce, and to that extent, your discharge will also be less. And I think that's where we have to move towards. We have to move from a 23.2% annual consumption to a higher consumptive figure and a lower discharge figure. Next. Now, if you look at, again, these are much more recent numbers, 2020. And if you look at these four sectors of industry, the largest, apart from engineering, because it's very difficult for me to quantify engineering, because, as I said, they're very disaggregated. But keeping engineering out of our discussion, textiles is a very major consumer at about 1,500 million liters per day, followed by iron and steel, which is 1,200 liters per day, followed by pulp and paper, and then of course distillery. This just to give you an idea as to what today's consumption is. Next. Can we go back to the previous one? Yes. Now this is an interesting slide, and again it's on the log frame, the y-axis, so that's why you'll not be able to see the rate of growth. You almost feel that they're almost the same, but that's not true. The blue talks about consumption in 2020. The red is on consumption in 2025. And you would find that it is increasing by 30 to 50% in industry after industry, whether it's soft drinks, whether it's fruit juices, bottled water, tea is almost the same, coffee as well as dairy. So the rate of increase of water consumption in 5 years to almost 20 to 50% is characteristic not just about the food and beverage sector, but it's also characteristic of some of the other sectors. So that's what that kind of underscores the point I made early in the earlier graph, that the rate of growth of the industrial sector and the thermoelectric sector is probably the highest compared to the other sectors, and one needs to now take action today for both water conservation and the following energy conservation too. Next. Now, if you take textile processing, and you compare the countries in the region, and you compare India with, let's say, Vietnam, Bangladesh, China and India, there's something like there's a fair amount of difference in how they consume water as well as energy. The blue line shows specific water intensity, and the red shows specific energy intensity. Specific water intensity is defined by liters per kg of cloth, and specific energy intensity is given by megajoules per kg of cloth. Now, you would find that Bangladesh has the highest specific water intensive among the four countries at 199 liters per kg of cloth, and China has the lowest in terms of energy intensity at 3.64 megajoules per kg of cloth. And India has done better than the other two countries, Bangladesh and China, as far as water is concerned, because we have an intensity of only 85, but our energy intensity is rather high. Now, this gives you a first order magnitude of how each of these countries perform. But one must keep in mind that the technologies may be different, and the energy resource consumption patterns would be different, and therefore they all have an impact on the energy and water intensity. But just to give you an idea as to how India compares with some of the other countries in the region. Vietnam, for instance, has a very high specific energy intensity and has moderately low water energy intensity. Next. Now, if you look at the pulp and paper industry, and here I could not get information from pulp and paper mills outside of India. So we looked at 12 leading pulp and paper mills in India. The mills were representative in terms of the diversity in pulping technology and the grades of paper produced, whether they produce newsprint or packaging or stationery or specialty paper. But the figure provides a snapshot of the water and energy benchmarks of these 12 paper mills. The average national benchmark of specific water intensity and specific energy intensity is 8.43 cubic meters per BDMT. BDMT stands for bone dry metric ton, and specific energy intensity, as I said, is 81.43 cubic meters per BDMT, and specific energy intensity is 50.58 gigajoules per BDMT. Now, four mills in the country were below that benchmark. That means that it is better than the benchmark. One is Tamil Nadu paper industry, JK paper mills, ITC, and Seshasayi. Whereas one of the built, that is the Balarpur paper industry, did rather well, built two, but others were higher, and largely due to older technologies such as use the Orient paper. Now, this kind of analysis provides a first order understanding, or this kind of gap analysis, first order understanding of the opportunities which mills would present themselves in terms of improving their specific water consumption and specific energy consumption. Next. Again, an interesting study was done by C Kinetics firm in Delhi on specific water use intensities for the wide range of common beverages and food products manufactured in India, such as soft drinks and fruit juices and bottled water and tea, coffee, milk and milk products, sugar, packaged food, and so on and so forth. It might be a surprise to note that the manufacture of coffee, from raw beans to their processing and final packaging, was the most water intensive, much more than tea or soft drink. The related energy consumption is also much higher. the process of producing and brewing coffee is water intensive. In fact, it takes 35 liters of water to produce 1 kg of coffee powder. And if you compare that with tea, tea only takes about 5 liters. It's just an analysis within the food and beverage industry as to how they compare in terms of water intensity. Next. This is on steel, and as I said, steel is a major water consumer. And this compares specific water consumption from 4 leading iron and steel plants in India. The mills were, again, representative of the diversity in terms of ownership, whether the public or private sector, steel manufacturing technology, steel product mix, whether they manufacture rolls or flats, carbon and alloy steels, and so on. And I think the diversity captures the average performance of steel mills with respect to water use in the country. Again, the figure provides a snapshot of the specific water intensity of the major steel plants. The average national benchmark of water intensity and energy intensity is 5.9 cubic meters per ton of steel. And when you compare that with SAIL, which is the public sector undertaking, actually SAIL has done very well at 3.75. Close behind them is Tata Iron and Steel, which is 3.9, and then you have Bhushan Steel. RINL, which is the Rashtriya Ispat Nigam Limited in Vizag, is very, very high in terms of water consumption. Compared to some of the other plants. But here the point is the steel industry is all congregating around data which is fairly competitive, excepting for RINL. And the public sector has done actually better than the private sector here as far as water consumption, specific water consumption is concerned. Next. Now, let me change tack from the data I showed about water consumption and benchmarking textiles, and steel, and food industry to talk about what are the water energy nexus opportunities. See, any energy water nexus opportunity in industrial plants has two components. The energy cycle, that is the in-plant generation of heat and power, the purchase of power, energy distribution, and its end-use utilization. That's the energy cycle. And the second component is the water cycle, the withdrawal of fresh water, its conveyance, its storage, its utilization, its treatment, including reuse, potential recycling, treatment, and final discharge. Now, both these components have 4 vectors, 2 for each. Process improvement in energy and energy efficiency is 2 vectors on the energy cycle, and process improvement in water and water efficiency on the water cycle. And both of these are interdependent and interconnected, as we discussed earlier. And let's look at how these perform in the context of some specific case examples. Next. Now, before I get into case examples, I just wanted to make this point about conventional pumping systems as compared to optimized pumping systems. Now, pump systems, as you know, are major energy users and responsible for about 20% of electricity consumed in industry. The use of pumps is highest in process industry like petrochemicals and the pulp and paper and chemical industry. Although pump systems are common in most forms of industry. Now, studies indicate that pumping efficiency in manufacturing plants can be less than 40%. And that's because of the cascading impact of inefficiencies all along the line. So if you have a standard motor efficiency of 90%, and a coupling efficiency of 98%, and a pump efficiency of 77%, and the total efficiency of 66%. And if you were to kind of look at the impact of the inefficiencies and compound them, then your output power is only 31%. That is just a third of the input. So the overall efficiency of this pumping system is just on 31%. Now one could optimize this by having a variable speed drive, a higher efficiency motor, higher coupling efficiency, and improved piping efficiency, and improved pump efficiency, and have an output power of 71.5%. So essentially, I just wanted to make the point, and I think this is very well known, that are probably the best examples of the water energy nexus, because pumps, as I said, contribute to 20% of the energy consumed in an industrial plant. And these kind of measures are required irrespective of what kind of process or what kind of technology is being adopted in the manufacture. This is something which is cross-cutting across all industry. Next. I think we need now to kind of look at water energy technologies and water energy savings potential. I don't know how difficult it is for you to read through all of this. I will not get into all the details because that will take a long time. But these five sectors, this is probably the one of the more important slides that I'm showing. These five sectors, textile, or rather five subsectors in industry, textiles, pulp and paper, iron and steel, food, and petroleum refining, together contribute to more than 50% of the industrial water use in India. There are several process technologies that could yield significant water and energy savings. For instance, in textile processing, and I just talk about a few of them. One is enzymatic dyeing. See, one can use enzymes for finishing of textile cloth at room temperatures. As you know, enzymes are proteins present in bacteria, and they're present in yeast and fungi, and they act as biocatalysts that activate and accelerate chemical reactions that would otherwise normally require more energy. And in enzymatic dyeing could save anywhere between 20 to 50% of water in a textile processing plant and about 15% energy. Then you have ultrasonic dyeing. You know, in dyeing process, the objective really is to diffuse the dye or chemicals into a fiber. And in this ultrasonic dyeing, this diffusion is assisted by ultrasound. It could save 20% water and 10% energy. Then there is, of course, many others such as electrobeam, ozone treatment, fiber pre-treatment, inkjet, electrochemical, and so on. But the foam technology is something which is, again, very cutting edge. One could save 80% water and anything like 65% of energy. And this is interesting because foam technology, it's foam finishing. It's an alternative method that uses air instead of water to apply dyes on textile materials. Because of this substitution of water by air, energy requirements in drying is dramatically reduced, as well as waste water disposal. Again, if you come to, and microwave, of course, can provide some of the heating requirements for drying and have significant amount of energy savings associated with microwave drying. But if you look at pulp and paper industry as another example, the Confederation of European Paper Industry identified six breakthrough technologies that have the promise to reduce water and energy consumption by 50% to 80% in pulp and paper manufacture, while at the same time adding 50% more in terms of value addition. Now, for instance, deep eutectic solvents produced by plants can produce pulp at low temperatures and atmospheric pressure. So with deep eutectic solvents, biomass can be dissolved into cellulose and lignin and hemicellulose in a process called omnivorous pulping, and can recover cellulose from waste and dissolve ink in recovered paper, and can save anything between 40% energy and 10% water. Similarly, you have flash condensing steam. See, in pulping, water is the key enabler, and hence there's the great demand for energy demand in paper making, because you need steam and hot water and so on. The flash condensing steam process, very, very interesting, is a waterless paper production process. And in this process, dry fibers are dispersed in agitated steam and blasted into a foaming room, and condensed. And therefore, one could have pulping of pulp and paper, pulping of the pulp, rather, using dry pulp without using any water whatsoever. So there is water savings of 100%. There are other technologies too, and I don't know whether I have the time to go through all of them, but essentially wanted to leave behind the point that there are emerging technologies by 2030, which should be in commercial parlance, be applicable and save enormous amount of water and energy. In the case of iron and steel and food and petroleum refining, I'm basically showing benchmarks of how, what are the international benchmarks that India needs to meet in terms of both process use, process water use, as well as waste water discharge. And I have some numbers here, and I'm not going to go through all of it. But essentially, India is nowhere close to what the international benchmarks are concerned, either in iron and steel, food, or petroleum refining. Next. Here are some very quick case examples. You know, Indian industry has not lagged behind. Indian industry has stepped to the plate, at least in some companies, and have shown energy savings and water savings through the energy water nexus opportunities, exploiting the energy water nexus opportunities of several projects. Many of these projects have a payback of anywhere between 2 months to 3 years. For instance, you have a thermal power plant which required a replacement of conventional cooling towers by air-cooled condensers, a payback of just about 28 months, an investment of 18 crores, and annual energy and water savings of 7.5 crores. You have a heavy engineering plant which treated sewage water in cooling towers. They set up a 500 meter cube sewage treatment plant, installed a softener, and then they used this water in the cooling tower, and the return on investment was less than a year. Then you have several paper mills, you know, two paper mills. You know, there's this paper mill which used effluent, you know, which used de-inking and coating effluents with significant fiber recovery. There was a reduction in turbidity on account of that. But the more important thing is that with an investment of 24 lakhs, the way it was 14.4 lakhs, return on investment of just about a year and a half. Beverage industry, as I showed earlier, has very risen to the, has done quite well because. For instance, in this particular plant, it is reuse of rinse water for glass water bottle washing. Almost 60% of the rinse water was collected, and fresh makeup water was reduced. Steel industry, which, as you know, is fairly water intensive, has also had some very interesting projects. For instance, the steel industry from the captive power plant, using the cooling water blowdown, you know, the cooling water systems in industry are major opportunities for water conservation. And one could do that largely through avoidance of cooling tower salt deposits. You know, there is a number of salt deposits, and if you could avoid salt deposits, one can reduce cooling water consumption dramatically. And there was a glass industry which used cooling water blowdown for cullet washing in a drum, in a perforated drum, and then recovered the wastewater and used it for further reuse. And then you have refineries. This is an interesting plant in Gujarat, which installed a reverse osmosis and ultrafiltration plant for wastewater treatment. Return on investment was just 29 months, and so on and so forth. So essentially, I wanted to leave behind the thought that Indian industry have introduced innovative methods in their processes to reduce water consumption and associated energy consumption with return on investments, which are very, very attractive, between less than a year to about 3 years. Next. This is my last slide, and I think I've taken a lot more time than I had planned. But Jairam, and you kind of said that I have all the time in the world, so I kind of elaborated.
No problem.
Yeah. See, this is important both at the state level as well as at the national level, and I thought I'd leave behind this particular figure. Mainly to kind of get people's reactions to where do we move from here. We heard thus far about the industrial sector's water consumption, the opportunities that lie ahead of us in various subsectors, but how do we ensure the accelerated implementation of these measures? So this is a roadmap which can be followed at a state level by EMC, or at a regional level, or at a national level by the Bureau of Energy Efficiency, or by a new bureau or on water efficiency, the Bureau of Water Efficiency. See, over a 15-month process, one could conduct an investigation with actionable measures to advance water and energy use and efficiency in industry. It involved establishing an energy water committee, an executive committee, an energy water nexus advisory group, and conducting in these five sectors. There could be other sectors too, but these are the ones which occur to me to be the most water intensive. In these five sectors, a number of steps, the first being gap analysis workshop. I think it's very important. I showed a few data on the gap analysis on water and energy consumption in textile and pulp and paper and so on, but one now needs to take it to the next level and do further analysis and have workshops with experts to identify very specific technological gaps. This could lead to another series of events which will focus on technological innovations. Which need to be implemented, need to be designed and developed and implemented. And this could be done through consortia, as Hari mentioned in his presentation. And this could all lead to very specific R&D direction and priorities. And keeping in mind that much of what we talk also has cross-cutting policy and economic issues, policy issues related to pricing, policy issues related to regulation, policy issues related to benchmarking, and so on. So working both at the macro policy level and working at the micro level in gap analysis and technological innovations and developing R&D priorities, one could come out with a statewide or nationwide energy water network roadmap, which will provide very clear sense of direction and global perspective, keeping in mind the global situation too. So this was just an attempt to kind of schematically put together a program where one could develop a schematic roadmap for the country. Next. So this is my conclusion. One is water energy co-management represents the key conservation opportunity in Indian industry. I think that's come up very clearly in terms of the fact that 20 to 30% of water of energy is used in the processing of water in process industry, and it's true across the board in water intensive industries. It's a bit higher, but 20 to 30% is a conservative estimate of the water of the energy savings potential associated with water use. Just like to make a very quick point here that I was talking to somebody in a seminar in Washington D.C. Who was from California, and California has a very arduous, rigorous water energy nexus program in Californian industry. And he said that the energy savings on account of a number of technological interventions in industry in California, number of technological interventions on water use in California, the energy savings associated with it was greater than all the energy efficiency measures that the state could implement. That is, if you were to look at just the water energy nexus and the saving opportunities in energy on account of the water conservation opportunities, it will be much larger than all other energy saving potential in the state. I don't know how true that is in India, but that's something that we need to analyze. There is improvement in water reduction, reuse, and recycling as major energy co-benefits. And clearly, that has been seen in some of the more advanced countries where water reuse and recycling and water reduction has been the single most measure to reduce the withdrawal of water, and it has major energy co-benefits. Again, there are significant emerging technologies, as I mentioned, in water and energy intensive technologies and textiles and paper, and I mentioned a few of them. And finally, you know, there's a need for implementation of a state, regional, or national level water energy nexus roadmap. And I just showed a schematic of a particular roadmap, but that could be discussed further. So with this, thank you very much. Thank you, Jayaraman. Thank you, EMC. And look forward to any questions you might have.
Thank you, Padu, for that wonderful presentation. I'm really thank the other panelists also, especially Dr. Dubey and Dr. Hariharan, for answering to some of the questions that already been posted on the chat box. Since we are running on excess timing, I think it was really useful for them to answer then and there itself. And I think instead of going into each and every question, most of the questions being posted in the chat box has been answered. So I think it is better that if anybody has something that has not been answered in that, they can unmute and ask this question, and we can.
Sir, I tried to answer most of the questions I had been asked, and referred few reports also in this connection. Am I audible?
Yes,
you are. Yes, yes. Thank you.
JC, may I suggest that you possibly close the session since we don't have any more questions. Maybe, you know, they could all write to the speakers later.
Sir, I have answered most of the questions.
Yes, right. We heard you. Yes.
Apart from that, I will share my mail ID. You can please mail it to me. I will reply back over to mail if anything is left. Thank you, sir.
Hello. Can you hear me?
Yes.
I think I lost connectivity in between for a couple of minutes. Am I audible now?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. So once again, thanks to the panelists and all the nice presentations. I'll just pick up some of the questions if they're not answered in the chat box. One is Muthumariyappan had asked a question. It is the need of the hour to insist on water audit and energy audit and subsequent conservation measures in all water sectors. It's not a question, actually, a statement. This aspect is to be given importance by taking appropriate levels. I think that has been well appreciated by all the presenters. And I think most of the questions in the chat box have been answered. So if anybody has any question, please unmute and ask that question to the panel.
The figure mentioned by you for the question.
Pardon?
Sorry. I am Gopal Krishna from Hyderabad.
Okay, okay. Yeah, go ahead.
This is to Mr. Padmanabhan. The figure what you have mentioned for Rashtriya Ispat Nigam, Vishakhapatnam, the water consumption figure, I have a doubt about those figures. Because they have done a lot of improvements in the water conservation and they have brought down the figures. And they have not internationally any of the field factories. But somehow I was surprised to see that the figures are different in your presentation. Kindly cross check that.
I will see, as I said, I drew upon these figures based on 2006 data. I didn't have more current data. And certainly, it's been 10 years since then, so they would have definitely done a lot more.
They make an improvement in the water conservation.
Yes. So it's very likely that they may have made improvements. This was, as I said, 2006 data drawn from the Center for Science and Environment, which had the basic information. But I would also like to make another point here. And this is not to do with this particular question, but rather to a more general point, which I thought some of the others have raised, the entire issue of regulations and whether one could have energy and water regulation. I think the time has come for a set of regulations for water efficiency use. We have regulations on the discharge of water, the quality of water, the contamination of water. But we have very little regulation, if at all, on the quantity of water that could be used for manufacture of a specific product. I think we need now to kind of move towards developing a Bureau for Water Efficiency, much like the Bureau of Energy Efficiency. I don't know whether that has been discussed earlier. There has been some discussions of it in Delhi, but I think it's time that that one has a Bureau for Water Efficiency, which could then benchmark water use and come out with certain guidelines on water audits and so on and so forth. I think it's important.
Thank you, Dr. Padu. That's a wonderful suggestion. I think Dr. Anupama was sharing something about some regulatory organizations who are looking forward to energy and water audit. If you have any, want to add something more onto it, you can just elaborate on it.
had already referred it that one can see the I had given the reference of Triveni, CII Triveni reports, and in that actually they have explained at India basis, at national basis, the water audit, as well as I mentioned that nowadays the government of India is doing the like ESCOM and CII to conduct water audits, so that that these those reports can be referred.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Any more questions from participants? I have just one question to Padu, that why we are leaving out the utility companies, the large energy producers, electricity producers, who might be consuming quite a large amount of, especially the nuclear power plants?
I couldn't agree with you more. You know, the data which I showed involved industry as well as thermoelectric companies, that is your utility companies. And today the utility companies could be very, very major consumers of water. But let me tell you a case example in Nagpur, which when I was at USAID, we helped support, which actually addresses a key issue of the Paradi power plant of Maharashtra State Electricity Board. The Maharashtra State Electricity Board to Paradi power plant were going on for a 500 megawatt unit, an additional 500 megawatt unit, for which they were relying on groundwater for some of the cooling water needs. Now, groundwater in an area like Paradi has a direct clash with irrigation water, because the farmers there, you know, were also very anxious that groundwater is not used for cooling water, but is left for them to use for agriculture. So clearly there was a point of tension here until the municipal commissioner in Nagpur approached us in USAID to find out whether we can think of any way in which we can provide the solution. And indeed, there was an interesting solution. And Nagpur itself had a lot of sewage water, and Nagpur is not very far away from this particular power plant. So we were able to come out with a feasibility study on the treatment of sewage water and the pumping of sewage water a distance of a couple of tens of kilometers to the power plant for users cooling water. And this project was financed by the Planning Commission. I forget the I think it was under the Jawaharlal Nehru mission, and was considered to be one of the best projects of its kind. So we were able to reduce significantly the extraction of groundwater and the energy savings thereof, and support this particular power plant. So this is one example, but I think such partnerships between municipalities and utilities are extremely important in order to advance the energy water nexus. These are swap opportunities where you swap water from one subsector and use it to another subsector. And there are many other examples which we have not even tapped in India. And now we need to kind of look at these options and opportunities, both from an energy perspective as well as from a water resource management perspective.
Thank you, Padu. EMC, can you unmute Muthumariappan? He wanted to ask you, please. Okay. There was a question from EMC itself. What could be the current net water consumption in cubic meter per kilowatt hour generation in India? Is there any study on this side?
Yes, there is one study. And as per that study, I don't have the current data, but as per 2010, approximately 40 billion cubic meter for withdrawal of coal. This is the estimate of IEA. I will refer that study and you can see that.
Thank you. Oh yeah, already there in the chat box.
Yes.
Also, the 2016, myself Dinesh Kumar, actually there was a study of water energy outlook in 2016. It says that approximately 50 billion cubic meters of water is being used in for power generation. Okay, and it is due for increase up to 80 billion cubic meter by 2040. What could be the current value or something like that? Is there any study or is there any benchmarking done recently, sir?
Yes, there has been, as Dr. Dubey said, there has been significant benchmarking done on water use in utilities. The NTPC power plants are tracking water management and water conservation very, very closely. Today, the information put out by the Central Electricity Authority not only looks at heat rate improvement in power plants, that is the kilocalories per kilowatt hour consumed, but also the gallons of water per kilowatt hour. So that is also been tracked very closely. So if you look at the CEA website, Central Electricity Authority website, you'll get this kind of information.
Thank you. If Mr. Muthumariappan can ask the question, I think we'll close with that question. We are already at 12:45. Can you unmute or can you speak, Mr. Muthumariappan? EMC, he was asking to unmute his mic. I think he is not able to hear. So I'll just, hello.
I think Mr. Muthumariappan need to refresh his screen. He's in now in listener's model. He has to connect it as a speaker.
So I think it's better that we can, with already running out of time, he can send the questions and we can get that answers from the experts later. And I'm handing over to Dinesh and the EMC representative. And thanks once again for all the panelists. Special thanks to Dr. Anupama Dubey, Padu, and Hariharan for that wonderful session. And I really enjoyed it. And thank you very much on behalf of all the participants. And over to EMC.
Thank you, Jeremy, sir. On behalf of Energy Management Center, Mr. Dinesh Kumar, would like to thank Dr. Anupama, Engineer Hariharan, and Shri Padu Padmanabhan for the nice as well as very informative discussion we had on this water energy nexus. This is one area which I think we have not addressed much in the recent times. As Padu sir was saying, we need to think about some agency to look into this water audit as well simultaneously to this energy efficiency drive. Thank you very much from Energy Management Center, and we look forward to working with you in future. Thank you.
Thank you so much, EMC. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, Jayaraman. Thank you very much.
Thank you all. Dinesh, will it be possible to share that recorded part with the participants? Dr. Mohandi had to leave a little early, so he was asking.
I'll send it across. No problem.
Thank you. Thanks a lot. Bye.
Bye.